money. Welcome in, everyone, to the Larson Land Podcast. I'm your host, Sawyer Hill, and I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, Dylan Bradshaw. We come in here every single week and talk about all things involving the 2021 NASCAR Cup Series champion, Young Money Kyle Larson. It would have been a victory Monday here on the Larson Land Podcast, but instead a victory Tuesday. Got home from London late last night, was there for the Ravens game. Thankfully, they won, but big time win also for Kyle Larson in the HendrickCars.com number 5 team on Sunday at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We'll get to that in a little bit, but also, you know, the High Limit Sprint Car Series wrapped up a week ago today at the Lincoln Park Speedway. We'll also cover that on today's podcast, as well as Kyle Larson's IndyCar rookie orientation that took place on Thursday. Lots of stuff to get into. Dylan, first and foremost, how are you doing?
Yeah, I'm good. I mean, pretty eventful week, you know, for Larson and, you know, obviously Larson Land, you know, locking into the round of 8 for Larson and winning the High Limit Championship, rookie orientation, as you just said, and now he's locked into the final 4 after the win at Vegas. So pretty good week, very eventful. And, you know, just getting into it, I mean, it's been a week now since the High Limit race at Lincoln Park. That happened last Tuesday where Larson, he got the championship, got it over Rico. His first sprint car championship since 2010 in the NARC series. So, been a long time coming for Larson. I mean, kind of hard for him to, you know, compete for a championship, you know, just running a few races here and there throughout the year. But, yeah, I mean, it was a good race. Rico, it kind of seemed like he was checking out that race. He was leading the way, but, Larson only needed that top 6 finish to clinch the championship. So, just needed to, you know, keep it smooth. He was starting 7th. There was that one wreck there that almost caught Larson. I thought it was over. He came so close to getting involved, but he turned right last second, gained a couple spots from that. Then from there, he pretty much just battled Rico a little bit, but lost the second place spot to Tyler Courtney there at the end. But brought it home in a 3rd place finish, got the championship, got it all wrapped up. Great season for High Limit. I thought Larson was pretty much, you know, had it in the bag early in the year. He was just unstoppable, kind of faded off a little bit near the second half of the series, but. Yeah, Rico, he definitely gave him a run for his money. It was a great series. Congrats to Larson, obviously, on the championship. And, looking forward to what High Limit has to bring in the future.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a really successful season, I would say, for High Limit in their opening year. I think that Kyle and Brad were very pleased with how the season went. I mean, just judging from their interviews or their, I guess, podcast with Dale Jr., like the Dale Jr. download that they did at Lernerville, kind of their comments, listening to that, they seemed very pleased with how the season had gone to that point. And, I mean, obviously with Larson as the championship, I think there's people that have mixed feelings about that, him winning the championship in his own series. But, like you said, the battles with Rico all season were awesome. I think Rico, would have been a deserving champion as well if Larson were to not finish in the top 6 at Lincoln Park. But it was kind of interesting at Lincoln Park to see Kyle competing for a championship in a sprint car, because, you know, we're so used to seeing Kyle just go balls to the wall in the sprint car, and, you know, if he's not going to win the race, he really doesn't care where he finishes. And it's been cool to see him really race for points all season long in the sprint car, where, you know, maybe sometimes it's better just to, you know, play it safe a little bit. I mean, I think he probably could have tried or given it a little bit more to maybe beat Rico at Lincoln Park, but at the end of the day, the points championship was on the line. Fell back to 3rd there in the closing laps, but cool to see Larson win a sprint car championship, and hopefully it gives him some momentum. It looked like it did give him some momentum going into the NASCAR race on Sunday, and maybe he'll be able to win 2 championships this year.
Yeah, everyone always talks about, you know, winning in his own series. I mean, he's racing against the top guys. Like, it's not like he's just, you know, beating up on some little, I don't know, 15, 16-year-old sprint car drivers. I mean, you have the top guys coming in to compete. Obviously, you know, World of Outlaw guys and the guys just, you know, they're not running the championship part of it. But, you know, every week that they race, I mean, Larson, he didn't have worse than the top 10.
His worst finish was 8th at Lernerville.
Yeah, and then he had the huge win streak, 3 or 4 wins in a row, something like that.
Three in a row.
Yeah, so I mean, just pure domination, and I mean, he's going up against the top talent, and you know, he doesn't race a sprint car, you know, full time like a lot of these other guys. So it just makes it that much more impressive. So I don't know. Looking forward, like I said, to what High Limit has to bring. Maybe a lot bigger, you know, season in store, more than 11 races. You know, only time will tell on that front, but successful season, and now, you know, racing is kind of winding down as we're approaching the end of the NASCAR season. Larson got that win at Vegas, and you know, that just leaves Homestead, Martinsville, and then Phoenix in early November. So racing season, you know, coming to a close. It's kind of depressing, but it's been a pretty successful year so far for Larson.
Yeah, I mean it's been that was Larson's 20 or Vegas was Larson's 20th win on the season, so a lot of wins in a lot of different types of race cars, and kind of wrapping up with the high limit side of things. I mean, Larson, just wanted to point out Larson with 3 wins on the season. Rico actually had more wins with 4, but I think Larson's consistency, like we just said, no finish worse than 8th at Lernerville. That's what propelled him to that championship. I agree, like you said. I mean, it with not being able to see some of the outlaw guys run the schedule full time, it was more of just a, I mean, there was great competition every week, but I would love to see next year maybe a bigger schedule, or maybe some additional drivers full time in the series, because I think you know, the crowds were good. Obviously, big money midweek. I think it was a huge success. So looking forward to High Limit in 2024. I know we're probably going to get a lot of announcements and stuff like that coming in the next few months. Like you said, racing season winding down, probably the end of Kyle Larson's 2023 sprint car campaign as a whole at Lincoln Park. So, pretty successful season for Kyle on the sprint car side of things, winning the Knoxville Nationals. You know, that's the biggest one. Obviously, we wanted the million earlier in the year in July, but didn't work out there, obviously. But winning Knoxville, obviously, never can be a bad season when you win the Knoxville Nationals.
Yeah, I just wish we saw him in the late model more this year. I mean, I love watching the late model. Love seeing him in there. So hopefully he runs some more late model next year. Although I don't know, because you know, like we just said, they could expand the high limit schedule. That could, you know, make his schedule even more busier than it is if he you know, continues to run full time. So yeah, I don't know, but I would love to see him in the late model, but a little bit more. Didn't get to see him too much, but yeah, I mean, the high limit, it was great to see, you know, consistent racing from Kyle. You know, a lot of times you just have the NASCAR and then it's just sporadic races. So it was nice to have a schedule in place for, you know, dirt racing and what you can expect from there. So, yeah, really happy with how it turned out and looking forward to it next year.
Yeah, I mean, both of the races that I went to were fun for High Limit, Grandview and Bridgeport, and you know, I loved the selection of tracks. I think that when the schedule was announced at the end of last year, there were a lot of tracks on there that I was surprised to see, but I was also very happy to see, like, Bridgeport and Grandview, two of those tracks that you know, put on a good show, but we haven't really seen them on too big of a stage, I would say. So it was cool to see those tracks on the schedule. Hope to see some more cool tracks next year, and yeah. So moving on to Thursday, Kyle Larson took to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for his first time in an IndyCar. So big time rookie orientation test there, Dylan. What were your thoughts on Kyle's first time making his way around the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in an IndyCar over 200 miles an hour? Pretty cool stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I wish it was broadcasted. I mean, it seemed like there was, you know, so much, you know, hype around it. So many people there, just, you know, sitting in the infield, sitting in the stands, witnessing. And I think they definitely could have broadcasted it because enough people cared about it to do
Yeah.
so. But yeah, I mean, it was really cool. He turned total 72 laps there. Obviously, passed the rookie orientation to qualify in 2024. A lot of people were concerned, you know, with the lap times. He turned a fast lap with 217.898. The cars are capped. I mean, they're not running like race speed. They kind of like tune it down a little bit for the rookie program. So a lot of people were worried about that saying like, oh, he's super slow compared to the Indy 500 qualifiers, but they're not gonna, you know, throw a new guy in there full speed to, you know, on the track. But yeah, it was really cool. But like I said, I just wish there was, you know, more footage of it, maybe a broadcast or so. But you know, was just kind of keeping track on the race control that they had. Was seeing him gradually get faster. I think the fast lap he had was around, I think it was lap 65. So he was definitely getting better, adjusting better. I know he said that one of the harder parts was getting slower. To the slower times, because you had the three stages of the certain mile per hour that you had to hit, and he said he it was kind of more difficult to hit the slower part. So, but yeah, from what Larson had to say in the interviews, he really enjoyed it. He said it was, I guess, a little bit easier than he thought. He said the speed and the grip, you know, wasn't as scary as he thought it might be. So, all in all, he seemed to be pretty comfortable based off his interviews.
Yeah, and kind of like piggybacking off of those like interviews, some of the other things that he said in his interviews, I have noted down here. You know, he noted that he wanted to work on some minor things like, you know, pit road. He thought he noted, he talked about how the steering was a lot different. You know, obviously no power steering in the IndyCar, so that's a very different feel altogether. But on pit road, like at the slower speeds, like turning into the pit stall and stuff like that, a little bit tougher to turn at that slow speed. And then also just like maximizing speed using the apron, like coming back onto the track, like after a pit stop, stuff like that. But yeah, I mean, all in all, again, like you said, it was kind of hard to say much about the test just because we couldn't watch it. We weren't there in person, and there wasn't a ton of footage of it. I was kind of on YouTube earlier looking, trying to find some videos and things, but I think I guess the surprising thing from me from the press conference that I took away was I thought that this was probably going to be Kyle's last opportunity to be in the IndyCar until April, until the Indy 500 Open test. But Tony Kanaan, the new sporting director of Arrow McLaren, said that they want to get Kyle in the IndyCar one more time before the open test in April. So we know it won't be on the Indianapolis Motor Speedway, but maybe we'll see him at Texas or Homestead or something for another test session before we see him back at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway in April, before the month of May kicks off.
Yeah, that'd be cool. Hopefully, Miami. I might have to make the trip down if they're not broadcasting or anything. Go to Miami.
Yeah.
Wish I was going next week, but took that Bristol trip. That was kind of a lot. So, but yeah, I mean, if you test at Miami, that'd be really cool. Might have to make the trip. I think it's about 5 hours or so from me. So, yeah, really cool stuff. But hopefully they broadcast it, because love to see him, you know, turn some laps. Everyone was kind of expecting like David Land to you know, show more Larson footage, but I kind of scrolled through his video a little bit. I didn't really see too much. I know he said in the beginning it wasn't, you know, a Larson video, but yeah, just all in all, just not a lot of footage. Wish we saw more, but seemed pretty successful so far.
Yeah, and I mean, as far as that the test goes, if it's something at Homestead, I guess we kind of don't. If you're gonna go, we don't want it to be broadcast, right? We'll make a
Oh
big
yeah,
big
true.
YouTube video. We'll be the only ones with video. We could live stream it on YouTube or something crazy like that and get a ton of viewers, ton of exposure for us. But no, we're not in it for the exposure for us. But yeah. IndyCar stuff is ramping up for Kyle. It's cool to see it. You know, we've been, I know I've been waiting for it for the past couple of years. I've been just itching to see Kyle getting an IndyCar. I've been going the past 2 years to the Indy 500 and experiencing that race. And I actually just got my email today with my tickets for the race in 2024, back in Southwest Vista. I think I'm in row Q this year, so a couple rows higher than what I was last year. So excited for that, and excited for Indy altogether. But any other thoughts on Indy, Dylan?
No, I mean, not really. I mean, hopefully next year you could hit Indy and I can maybe hit Charlotte, or you know, kind of pull off like a Larson double video. That'd be pretty cool. So We'll have to plan something like that. It'd be a really cool day to cover. We just really gotta pray that there's no rain, so he can, that's one thing. I think someone talked about that with the rookie test. It might have been Tony Kanaan, but because I think he would be the fill-in driver if Larson couldn't finish out the 500. But let's not talk about that. Let's not
Don't say the
discuss
R
that.
word.
We'll not say that. So yeah, hopefully everything's good, and he can complete the double, and first time since 2014 with Kurt Busch, who did pretty well in the IndyCar. So hopefully Larson, he can get it going and put up a good finish, or hopefully win.
Yeah, so speaking of winning, at Las Vegas, Kyle Larson on Sunday, big time win, locking himself into the championship four at Phoenix, sweep of the stages for Larson after qualifying second on Saturday. It was the Christopher Bell and Kyle Larson show all weekend long. It kind of felt like an old chili bowl or something, with those guys battling it out. Bell knocked Larson off of the pole as the last driver to qualify on Saturday, and it was the same two drivers crossing the finish line first on Sunday, but in the reverse order. Man, Dylan, I didn't get to watch this race every single lap of it. I was over across the pond. My YouTube TV wasn't working. I couldn't watch it from there, but I was trying to stay tuned in with the in-car camera, which I had available on NASCAR Drive. But it looked like a dominant day for Larson. There were points where he was really loose, and Bell looked like he had the better car. But between the two of them, I think there were some other comers and goers as the race went on. But it seemed like those two guys were really the ones to beat all day.
Yeah, it was pretty much Larson and Bell. Keselowski, he showed some speed there a lot. He was kind of leading around that point where we saw Larson had that big save that almost took him out. He Tokyo drifted the car and kissed the right rear with the wall. But yeah, I mean, from the initial part of the race, Larson, he took the lead from Bell pretty early. He was super loose most of the day, though. I mean, around that lap 30 mark, that's when Bell took the lead back, and then Larson, he gained the lead back over the pit cycle, and kept making adjustments throughout the day because he was super loose. But Larson, he took the he, or sorry, Bell, he lost the lead pretty quick there at the end of the stage one, because he took two tires instead of four. Larson, to just get in front of Larson, he took that lead back pretty quick, won the stage. And then obviously, like I just said, he had that huge drift moment. That was lap 141. Can't believe he saved that. Well, I can believe he saved that because he's done stuff like that before. But very timely caution right after that, because he flat spotted the crap out of his tires there. I was really scared for that they were going to blow. But Bowman, he slowed, he brought out a caution. Really, really timely caution, something we don't really see, for Larson working out in his favor. But that helped him a lot. And then near the end of the race, the last pit stop, five team, absolute money stop for the five team, locked in, got him some track position, got him two spots on pit road. And like I said, that was the last pit stop of the race. And from there, it was just Larson cruising until the end, where it got a little scary. He was fighting the loose car, having trouble with lap cars, and ended up beating out Bell by less than a tenth of a second. So it was definitely a close one. One more lap, and I don't know if he would have been locked into the four, but thankfully he was, and he was fast all day, swept the stages, and really deserving win. I mean, he led 133 laps. He was dominant. He really didn't fall out of the top five. I mean, even when he Tokyo drifted the car, he was still sitting fifth and made his way back up. So he was really quick, and it was a good win, really big win. We don't have to stress for the rest of the round. Although the next two tracks, he's also very good at. Homestead, he dominated last year in the win, got the Martinsville win early in the year. So, I would expect him to get a really good finish, if not a win, these next 2 weeks before he goes to Phoenix. And he also had a very, very good showing at Phoenix in the spring race. He led, I think, well over 200 laps. So, it's looking really good for this five team as we head into the final four.
I mean, like, I think we said it on the podcast last week, like, no joke, Kyle Larson has a chance to win every single race in this round. He's, you know, very good at Vegas, very good at Homestead, and then Martinsville, obviously the defending winner of that race from in the spring. Not a track that he's been historically good at, but the short track program for Hendrick Motorsports has been really good this year. I mean, it's, you know, we, like you said, Phoenix it was a strong point earlier in the season for this team, and you know, I'm very excited for Phoenix. I mean, I think that Kyle has a really good chance, and I was looking at it earlier before we came on the podcast. It's interesting because the last two races, or the last 2 years, two seasons in the next gen car, the winner at Las Vegas in the round of eight went on to win the championship, of course. Or actually, I guess last year in the next gen car, and then the year prior with Kyle Larson in 2021 winning at Vegas and then going on to win the championship. Last year, Joey Logano winning at Vegas and then winning the championship. So the past 2 years, the winner at Vegas having those extra 2 weeks to prepare, I guess, really specifically for Phoenix. Maybe that helped, maybe it didn't, but I know two more races to go before then, but it is good to know that, you know, you can go and race for the win the next 2 weeks and there's no consequence to wrecking. Anything crazy happens, you're good to go. And maybe that's a little bit of extra confidence. And I know Kyle talks about it in his post-race interview. You know, you don't want to get, complacent and not run good the next 2 weeks. You want to carry some momentum in there to Phoenix. But, you know, anything can happen. We've seen it every single year. There's always crazy stuff that goes down in these playoffs, so a win's a win, and we'll take it heading into the championship four.
Yeah, and another thing, Larson, he became the first driver to lead 1,000 laps in the next gen at Vegas.
Yeah.
So that was kind of surprising when I saw that tweet. He got it at the 102 laps lead mark, ended up leading 133, so just very good in the next gen, and it kind of put it in perspective. I mean, he led, what, 2,600 in 2021, and he just passed the 1,000 mark in the next gen. So,
and that's for like just this season, right? 1,000, right?
Yeah, well, first 1,000 this season, but in totality in the next gen.
In the next gen car.
Yeah,
in the next gen. That's pretty crazy.
Yeah. And so some stats I saw on Twitter after this Vegas win. So just to prove the domination of Larson at intermediate tracks, Larson has won 10 times in his career at intermediates and 9 since joining Hendrick at intermediates. And intermediate tracks actually account for 43.5% of his total wins in his career. So, and he has 23 wins in his career. 24 second place finishes at intermediate tracks, which is more than he has total wins in his career. Just dominant at these intermediate tracks, 5,200 laps led in 159 career starts intermediate tracks, 22 races where he led the most laps. So just very dominant on, you know, these mile and a half tracks, and, you know, just proving that after this Las Vegas win, leading 133. So I don't think, there's anyone better in NASCAR right now at the intermediates than Kyle Larson.
Yeah, I definitely have to agree with you there, and the stats don't lie when it comes to that, because Kyle is just, every time we go to one of these mile and a halves, I feel confident that I could put money on Kyle Larson to win, and he's going to win, because he's so good at the mile and a halves, and we got the best mile and a half for him coming up this week at Homestead, so hopefully another win on the horizon there. But just really want to point out the effort from the pit crew, really the entire season. I mean, this race was, a total team effort, as Cliff Daniels said on the radio after the race. The pit crew, they come in clutch as always. I mean, Kyle even said it in his post-race interview that he loves cautions and he loves pit stops, because every time he goes down pit road, those guys are so good that, you know, that's positions and time that he can gain with him really not even having to do anything. So sometimes, I guess, as a driver, it feels good to come down there, have a quick pit stop, and then come out ahead of the guy that was ahead of you before. So, I mean, pit crew has been really good this year, and I obviously, that team was clutch back in 2021, winning the championship at Phoenix. So maybe a repeat of a clutch stop at Phoenix to secure the championship again in 2023.
I hope not. I hope it doesn't get to the point where I mean, I trust.
But
in
we
them
know
to get
it's there. We know. We know that we have that. We have that team that we can. You know, Kyle. We have the best driver, and we have the best pit crew. It doesn't get much better than that.
Right. Yeah. They're always clutch when it matters. I mean, it seems like, you know, every time it's like the last pit stop in a race, they're always coming through, always getting, you know, some spots that he needs. So, but yeah, like I said, hopefully it doesn't get to that point. Hopefully, you know, it just stays green at Phoenix at the end. We can just sail to a nice stress-free victory and a Larson second championship. But you know, as history repeats itself, it's usually very stressful as a Larson fan. We all thought 2021 was in the bag, and you know, almost lost it there, but pit crew came in clutch, and we got the championship. So yeah, looking forward to it. Really looking forward to these next 2 weeks. He has a very good chance to win. Hopefully he you know, has another very dominant race at Homestead like he did in the last Homestead race, leading a ton of laps. I think he led 199 last year in that Valvoline car. So, yeah, really looking forward to this week, and then Martinsville, and yeah, Phoenix right after that. So really winding down at the end of the year. It's gone by pretty quick. You know, a lot of podcasts, a lot of weeks have gone by, but you know, we're nearing the end, which kind of sad, but you know, hopefully we can end it on a good note.
Yeah, I mean, it's winding down, and obviously we, you know, like we said a couple weeks ago, we know Kyle's going to be running the midget out west at Placerville for the Hangtown 100. That's a confirmed race for him, two nights there after the NASCAR schedule ends. So we at least know that. We got some races after the NASCAR schedule. Not sure if he's going to run any more of that western or California swing for the USAC National Midgets. But yeah, season winding down, episode 73 of the podcast. I mean, we talked about it before we came on here. It's crazy that we're 73 episodes into the podcast. You know, we really appreciate everybody's support, that's especially the ones that have been there since day one. There's been a lot of people that have supported us along the way, and we really, really appreciate the support on all of our social media platforms. We see the ones that are interacting with us on every single platform. You know, we love that too, because we love the double interaction. And yeah, we're looking forward to the end of the season here in 2023, and we know 2024 has a ton to bring, especially for you know, the IndyCar side of things, with Kyle Larson running the Indianapolis 500, and then, like we said before, the High Limit Sprint Car Series. An awesome 2023 campaign, and we're looking forward to 2024 there.
Yeah, I didn't think we'd make it this far. I thought we'd just get a few podcasts, you know, when we started, just kind of like a trial run. But, you know, the support was very good, and here we are. But, you know, even the growth with the podcast, I mean, going back, I don't even think I could bear to listen to one of the first few podcasts. They were so bad. And then we finally transitioned to the webcams, and that kind of made it better. But, yeah, I mean, the podcast, it's grown a lot. We've had a lot of great podcasts and you know, tons of support. So, you know, like you just covered, we just really appreciate the support from all you guys, you know, across all social media platforms. I mean, that's what keeps us going, and, you know, makes covering Larson that much more fun. You know, we're obviously Larson fans, but, you know, covering them, it's a lot to cover, but we know everyone out there, you know, really loves our posts, and, you know, loves interacting, and, you know, just loves keeping up with Larson. So it just makes it that much more motivating to, you know, keep on going and you know, keep on trucking. And yeah, it's gone great so far. So, you know, looking forward to the end of the year and looking forward to next year.
Absolutely. So, I think if unless you had anything else, Dylan, I think that should pretty much wrap up today's show. Thanks again, everyone, for tuning in and listening. We'll be back again next week to recap the NASCAR Cup Series from Homestead Miami Speedway, hoping for a win there. Maybe get a little win streak going here to end the season. But if you're watching this on YouTube, please don't forget to like this video and subscribe. And if you're listening on Apple Podcasts, please follow our podcast so you don't miss a thing. Hope everybody has a great rest of the week, and we will see you in the next episode.